First of all, it's an absolute pleasure to have you here, Anuradha, Ms. Anuradha Bhasin, one of the bravest women I know, executive editor Kashmir Times, and who's been so very vocal always, but especially this past 1 year, which has been such a difficult time for Kashmir particularly, but also Jammu and Ladakh. Anuradha, you've been saying, you've been talking, you've been writing, and you've been talking about battered, caged Kashmir. You've been talking about it being like on a time bomb. I want to ask you personally, how do you feel about the situation there? Personally, how do you feel as a senior journalist?
Personally, I feel shattered. As a human being, I feel shattered. Firstly, because, I mean, forget about whether the abrogation of Article 370 or whatever has happened thereafter is good for Jammu and Kashmir or not. I don't know, without getting into that debate. The government of India is deciding to change the future of the people of Jammu and Kashmir, to slice its geography, to change, alter its political status, and through that, completely alter also its society. And the people of Jammu and Kashmir were not included in that decision. They were not even asked. In far from asking them, they were put behind barbed wires. Early in the morning, we get up. I mean, Kashmir has always been a problem. People of Jammu ask that, we've always been nationalist. We've always, and in recent years, they've also been very pro-BJP. So they ask, you know, why early in the morning they suddenly get up and there is Section 144 in place few hours before the decision comes. So there is that sense of humiliation, first of all, that comes with it. Second, as a journalist, I think the last 1 year, the kind of challenges that I have faced as a media person or my other colleagues have faced, and particularly my colleagues in Kashmir Valley, I think we've never faced these kind of challenges. And these keep growing with the time.
Not
I mean,
even at the height of insurgency in 1989, not even as bad.
No, not like this. I mean, there was the gun, of course. It was a different kind of intimidation. The gun of the security forces and the gun of the militants. And the journalists had to negotiate between these threats. The militants wanted their statements to be highlighted without being edited. And the security forces, if you're going to do that, they're going to, take you to task. And so on and so forth. And people were killed, journalists were killed, journalists were kidnapped, journalists were beaten up, thrashed. These kind of things happened. But at that time, we had some confidence in the government. You know, there is a government we can talk to. There were attempts during the governor's rule to bring in censorship laws. The press got together, even though in those that peak militancy period, and got the government to revoke that decision.
Yeah.
Right now, there is nobody to talk to. You know, recently they came out with a media policy which
correct,
is so
correct.
Frightening.
Mm-hmm.
And even if I was trying to write about it and I needed some clarifications, I know that the local officers are nobody to speak about why this policy has been taken or the entire, aim behind it, the design behind it, or the philosophy behind it. I expected them to answer at least how this is going to be implemented. What are the rules that are going to be there? Who are the expert? Is there going to be an expert panel? Is it just going to comprise government officials, or there are going to be other people on board? They won't take up my calls. I sent messages. There is no response at all. They treat you as if you don't exist. And I'm somebody, I've spent 30 years in journalism. You know, and you think of what would happen to the younger journalists.
Yeah.
This is...
What about, you have described that media room where the young reporter has to, or all the reporters, young or otherwise, have to cram in to get little space because that's the only place to report. There's surveillance there and all of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, this is how it started, you know, and initially we thought maybe it won't last that long, but it seemed like a long haul. The thing that, because there was no communication system working, not just the internet, no mobile phones were working, no landline phones working. There's a complete silence. So after about a week, 10 days, the government set up the media facilitation center so that the journalists could work. So three computers to begin with, a couple of hours in a day, and 300 journalists at that time, because a lot of Indian journalists had also arrived in Srinagar. And this was only in Srinagar, not in any other district of the valley. So Srinagar journalists could work if they could jostle for space, get 15 minutes to do their stories, send it to their organizations, verify or authenticate information, get preliminary information. And that's how we work. You know, internet today is indispensable for many, many professions, including journalism. We constantly need that. So that was just not available. The other thing was, it's a government set up facility where your entire work is under surveillance. So even a phone call, you know, if somebody is calling me from there, my own staffers are calling, they're under so much pressure that the conversation is being heard. Before that, there was a man taking numbers, noting down who is the person called which number is it, and all these details were being noted down. And the computers, of course, they were there, so they all had the entire work there. So that kind of, one was the logistical impediment that was created in the functioning of media. The other was the way that Media Facilitation Center worked, and the way that some of the journalists were being harassed on the road, some of them being beaten up, their video footage being deleted, or some of the journalists being summoned by the police to report to the cybercrime police and give explanations about their story, even give away their sources. So this had created a climate of fear. And it was extremely oppressive working in that kind of a climate.
So there's intimidation, there's threat, there's fear. I want to know, for Anuradha Bhasin Jamwal, what is it like personally? What has it been personally this 1 year in Kashmir, in Jammu?
Personally, I mean, yes, of course, there is that sense of fear is there. You keep thinking about, you know, I mean, you're writing this. I do write what I have to write. So at the end of the day, because that's what keeps me alive. And I remember that when August 5th happened, there was so much of shock. I felt so shocked that I went into complete silence. 2 days, I said, okay, from here and henceforth, I'm not writing. I'm not going to speak anything. There's no point. It's completely pointless. And then I said, okay, I refused to be. One night, I couldn't sleep. The third night, I couldn't sleep. And then I said, I woke up middle of the night and I started writing. I had realized that, you know, I can't kill myself before somebody's killed me. And that's what keeps me alive. I think that just that spark in me to fight back, to continue talking. And I think there is a need to do that. If you are not going to puncture the very rosy narrative of the government, which is far from reality, if it's based on some facts, we are ready to accept it. If it isn't, it's our duty as journalists to, you know, counter that, and which is what I can't do, and I should be doing.
Are you able to visit the valley? Are you able to visit?
No, after the pandemic, I have not. Before that, I have, I haven't really gone to the valley much after August 5th, because first I was involved with the case, so there were more visits to Delhi than to the valley. And then, I went in February and March, but after that, I haven't been able to go.
You are a petitioner. You're one of the lead petitioners in the Supreme Court on the whole issue of internet 4G, the need for internet 4G as a means of the right to freedom of expression, etc. You got very limited results. What has that meant for you and for journalists in Kashmir? And for the people?
I mean, it meant, first, my petition to the court was on August 10th. The final verdict came on 10th of January, so exactly 5 months later. And we are going to court with something that is related to the fundamental rights, to basic necessity of people, to the basic necessity of a democracy, media being the fourth pillar of democracy, and media was in a state of freeze. So 5 months later, I think, is, as they say, justice delayed is justice denied. So to some extent, yes, that's true. The judgment itself was mixed. I mean, there was a positive element in it. It was significant in the way that it recognized that access to internet was part of free speech, and that government cannot impose restrictions for prolonged periods. However, it did not define prolonged period. The other thing that the court did not do is, even though it said that it was critical of the way the government had clamped down on the people, or had deprived people of their internet freedom, it did not say restore the internet immediately. Yeah. It put the ball in the government's court, asked them to review and put into public domain the reasons for why these restrictions are being made. So the government took another 2 months to gradually, in a phased manner, ease the restrictions on the internet. But even as of today, things are much better that way. I mean, we can have, in the valley, there is broadband. In Jammu and in rest of the state also, there is 2G is working. 4G is not working. And the majority of our customers in our country, they rely on the mobile internet, not on the broadband. Yeah. So it's created inequalities within a region.
Finally, Anuradha, where is the hope? Where is the hope for Kashmir, for Jammu and for Ladakh? Where do you see the hope?
I mean, right now, immediate future looks very, very bleak. Because even in Jammu and in parts of Ladakh, which earlier looked up to what has happened, they were happy that, you know, this will end Kashmiri domination. So they've started gradually realizing that they have something to lose, and they have a lot to lose, and especially after the laws have come in. So right now the situation seems bleak. But I think one needs to hang on, one needs to hold on to truth and inform as many people as possible, so that there would be some light some point in time.
And absolutely finally, what will be the implications of the laws that the government is bringing in for all three regions? If you can just quickly tell people.
Yeah. Look, quickly, said there is a domicile law which allows, different categories of people. It's pretty relaxed. Say 15 years, somebody has stayed here in Jammu and Kashmir, 10 years for bureaucrats and their families, those who have studied here for that 7 years. These kind of categories have been created, and these are all retrospective effect. There's no cutoff date. So I mean, somebody who settled here 70 years ago, maybe even before, and officials don't talk because to clarify these kind of ambiguities. The other thing is that the land, the laws related to land ownership, transfer of land, these have been amended so that any citizen today can purchase land in Jammu and Kashmir. So these are some of the changes. And these, it is feared that J&K had its Land Reforms Act, which gave land to the tiller. These will gradually, as bigger monopolies, whenever they come, it may take time. There is economic slump even in rest of the country. So we may not see it immediately, but we may see it in some point in time, that bigger monopolies will come and that whole process will be altered. Now, who were the beneficiaries in that? They were the peasants. There were a lot of people in Kashmir who benefited, the Muslims of Kashmir. In Jammu region, there were the scheduled castes, the Dalits who benefited.
From the land to the tiller.
Land to the tiller. And land to the tiller, if you see the kind of untouchability that is practiced in rest of India, Jammu has it. But it's not that it doesn't exist, but it is much, much less. It's always been much less. Now, is that process going to be reversed?
My God.
These are anxieties. In Ladakh, similarly, they fear that their tribal status is not going to be protected. Their ecology is not going to be protected. In Kashmir, the anxieties are also that the demographic nature of the region will be altered completely. It will no longer remain Muslim majority. So that's
lot of concerns and lot of worries. Some of us are very attached to Kashmir and Jammu and Kashmir and the entire region. And I think you have seen some support from democratic forces all over the country. We are all facing all our different battles in different parts of the country also. But I just want to say from all of us that we salute all of you and your bravery. Thank you so much for this conversation.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I salute you. Bye.